brothers Ancona and little Ephraim Robin John lived in Old Calabar in West Africa. The brothers were part of a slave trading dynasty headed by their relative, Grandy King George, one of the most powerful leaders of the Efik people. Grandy King George owned hundreds of slaves whom he employed to capture still more slaves in the African interior. He sold these captives to captains of European slave ships for transport to sugar, tobacco, and rice fields in the New World. British slave ship captains and African rivals conspired in 1767 to destroy Grandy King George's control of the slave trade. In a bloody battle, little Ephraim and Ancona Robin John were themselves enslaved and transported across the Atlantic to the West Indies. Unlike most slaves, the Robin John brothers spoke and wrote English, a skill they had learned as slave traders in Old Calabar. The Robin Johns escaped from the man who bought them in the West Indies and boarded a ship, determined to get home, little Ephraim wrote. But the ship captain took them to Virginia instead and sold them as slaves. After their Virginia master died in 1772, the Robin Johns heard that a slave ship from Old Calabar had recently arrived, and the captain promised to take them back to Africa if they would run away. They did, but the captain betrayed the Robin Johns and took them to Bristol, England, where he sought to sell them as slaves yet again. While imprisoned in Bristol Harbor, the Robin Johns smuggled letters to a Bristol slave trader they had known in Old Calabar. With his help, the Robin Johns appealed to the Chief Justice of England for their freedom on the grounds that they were unjustly enslaved. After complex negotiations, they won their freedom. The Robin Johns converted to Christianity in Bristol, but they longed to return to Africa. In 1774, they left Bristol as free men on a slave ship bound for Old Calabar, where they resumed their careers as slave traders. The Robin Johns' quest to escape enslavement and reclaim their freedom was shared but not realized by millions of Africans who were victims of slave traders such as Grandy King George and numberless merchants, ship captains, and colonists. In contrast, tens of thousands of Europeans voluntarily crossed the Atlantic to seek opportunities in the North American colonies, often by agreeing to several years of servitude. Both groups often experienced the violence and deceit beneath the surface of the 18th century Atlantic commerce that linked Britain, Africa, the West Indies, and colonial America. Many people, like the Robin Johns, turned to religious faith as a source of meaning and hope in an often cruel and unforgiving society. The flood of free and unfree newcomers crossing the Atlantic contributed to unprecedented population growth in 18th century British North America. In contrast, Spanish and French colonies in North America remained thinly populated outposts of European empires interested principally in maintaining a toehold in the vast continent. While the New England, Middle, and Southern colonies retained regional differences, commercial, cultural, and political developments built unifying experiences and attitudes among the colonists. Looking back at the statistics for the 17th century, you can see that the population growth was relatively slow at first, but picked up considerably after 1650. But when we get past 1700, that growth effectively doubles every 20 or so years, mainly due to immigration from Europe, particularly the British Isles, but also from rising birth rates and declining mortality rates. As with the other chart, the numbers and percentages in red indicate the African and African-American population, the overwhelming majority of whom were enslaved, roughly 93%. Not surprisingly, the black population of New England started out very small and actually shrunk in proportion to the white population throughout the 18th century. Slave labor had a greater importance to the agricultural economies of the middle colonies, but even so, slaves were greatly outnumbered by a white immigrant working class, while prosperous commercial farmers preferred the cheaper labor of indentured servants and redemptioners to slaves who were generally too expensive. Obviously, this was not a problem for the planter elites of the South, who imported large numbers of slaves, encouraged and sometimes forced them to have children in order to take advantage of laws mandating that children of slave mothers were themselves slaves. We'll come back to the importance of slavery to the Atlantic economy later. This eightfold growth of the colonial population signaled the maturation of a distinctive colonial society. In 1700, there were 19 people in England for every American colonist. By 1770, there were only three. Colonists of different ethnic groups, races, and religions lived in varied environments under 13 different colonial governments, all of them part of the British Empire. Immigration shifted the ethnic and racial balance among the colonists, making them by 1770 less English and less white than ever before. Fewer than 10% of 18th century immigrants came from England. About 36% were Scots-Irish, mostly from Northern Ireland. 33% were brought from Africa, almost all of them as slaves. Nearly 15% had left the many German-language principalities, and almost 10% came from Scotland. In 1670, more than 9 out of 10 colonists were of English ancestry, and only 1 out of 25 was of African ancestry. By 1770, only about half of the colonists were of English descent, while more than 20% descended from Africans. Overall, by 1770, the people of the colonies had a distinctive colonial rather than English profile. The booming population of the colonies points toward a second major feature of 18th century colonial society, an expanding economy. The nearly limitless wilderness stretching westward made land relatively cheap compared with its prices in the Old World. The abundance of land made labor precious, and the colonists always needed more. The bottomless demand for labor was the fundamental economic environment that sustained the mushrooming population. Economic historians estimate that free colonists, those who were not indentured servants or slaves, had a higher standard of living than the majority of people elsewhere in the Atlantic world. The New England population grew sixfold during the 18th century, but lagged behind the growth in the other colonies. Most immigrants chose other destinations because New England's land was relatively densely settled and because Puritan orthodoxy discouraged newcomers of other faiths. As the population grew, many settlers in search of farmland left towns, causing Puritan communities to lose much of their cohesion. Still, networks of economic exchange tied New Englanders to their neighbors, to Boston merchants, and to the broad currents of Atlantic commerce. In many ways, trade became a faith that competed strongly with the traditions of Puritanism. The New England population grew mostly by natural increase, much as it had during the 17th century. The perils of childbirth gave wives a shorter life expectancy than husbands, but wives often lived to have 6, 7, or even 8 children. Anne Franklin and her husband Josiah, a soap and candle maker in Boston, had 7 children before Anne died. Josiah quickly married his second wife, Abia, and the couple had 10 more children, including their son Benjamin, who became one of the most prominent colonial leaders of the 18th century. Like many other New Englanders, Benjamin Franklin felt hemmed in by family pressures and lack of opportunity. He ran away from Boston when he was 17 to assert my freedom, as he put it, landing first in New York and then in Philadelphia. The growing New England population pressed against a limited amount of land. As the northernmost British colonies, New England had frontiers inhabited by powerful American Indians, especially the Iroquois and the Mohicans, who defended their territory. Disputes with the Catholic French colony of New France also menaced the British and mostly Protestant New England colonies. During the 17th century, New England towns parceled out land to individual families. In most cases, the original settlers practiced partible inheritance, that is, they subdivided land more or less equally among sons. By the 18th century, the original portions of land allotments had to be further subdivided. Many plots of land became too small to support a family. Sons who could not hope to inherit enough land moved away from the town where they were born. During the 18th century, colonial governments in New England abandoned the 17th century policy of granting land to towns. Needing money, the governments of both Connecticut and Massachusetts sold land directly to individuals, including speculators. Now money, rather than membership in a community bound together by a church covenant, determined whether a person could obtain land. The new land policy eroded the 17th century pattern of settlement. As colonists spread north and west, they tended to settle on individual farms rather than in the towns and villages as in the 17th century. Far more than in the 17th century, 18th century New Englanders regulated their behavior by their own individual choices. A New England farm was a place to get by, not to get rich. New England farmers grew food for their families, but their fields did not produce large surpluses that could be sold. Instead of one big crop, farmers grew many small ones. If farmers had extra, they sold to or bartered with neighbors. Poor roads made travel difficult, time-consuming, and expensive, especially with bulky and heavy agricultural goods. The one major agricultural product the New England colonies exported, livestock, walked to market on its own legs. By 1770, New Englanders had only one-fourth as much wealth per capita as free colonists in the southern colonies. As consumers, New England farmers participated in a diversified commercial economy that linked remote farms to markets throughout the Atlantic world. Merchants, large and small, stocked imported goods, British textiles, ceramics and metal goods, Chinese tea, West Indian sugar and rum, and Chesapeake tobacco. Farmers' needs supported local shoemakers, tailors, wheelwrights, and carpenters. Larger towns, especially Boston, housed skilled tradesmen such as cabinet makers, silversmiths, and printers. Shipbuilders, sailors, and fishermen were among the many New Englanders who made their fortunes at sea. Fish accounted for more than a third of New England's 18th century exports. Livestock and timber made up another third. The West Indies absorbed two-thirds of all New England's exports. Slaves on Caribbean sugar plantations ate dried, salted codfish caught by New England fishermen, filled barrels crafted from New England timber with molasses and refined sugar, and loaded those barrels aboard ships bound ultimately for Europeans with a taste for rum, made from molasses, and sweets. The rest of New England's exports went to Britain and continental Europe. This Atlantic commerce benefited the entire New England economy, providing jobs for laborers and tradesmen as well as for ship captains, clerks, merchants, and sailors. Merchants dominated Atlantic commerce. The largest and most successful New England merchants lived in Boston, at the hub of trade between local folk and the international market. By 1770, the richest 5% of Bostonians owned about half the city's wealth. The poorest two-thirds of the population owned less than one-tenth of the city's wealth. Still, the incidence of genuine poverty did not change much. About 5% of New Englanders qualified for poor relief throughout the 18th century. Overall, colonists were better off than most people in England. New England was more English in origin than any other colonial region. People of African ancestry, almost all of them slaves, numbered more than 15,000 by 1770. But white people made up 97% of the population. Most New Englanders had little use for slaves on their family farms. Instead, the few slaves lived in towns, especially Boston, where most of them worked as domestic servants and laborers. By 1770, the population, wealth, and commercial activity of New England differed from what they had been in 1700. Ministers still enjoyed high status, but Yankee traders had replaced Puritan saints as the symbolic New Englander. Atlantic commerce competed with religious convictions in ordering New Englanders' daily lives. In 1700, the middle colonies of Pennsylvania, New York, New Jersey, and Delaware had only half the population of New England. By 1770, the population of the middle colonies had multiplied tenfold and nearly equaled the population of New England. Immigrants, mainly German, Irish, and Scottish, made the middle colonies a uniquely diverse society. By the late 18th century, barely one-third of Pennsylvania's and less than half the total population of the middle colonies traced their ancestry to England. New white settlers, both free and in servitude, poured into the middle colonies because they perceived unmatched opportunities. Germans made up the largest contingent of migrants from the European continent to the middle colonies. By 1770, about 85,000 Germans had arrived in the colonies. Their fellow colonists often referred to them as Pennsylvania Dutch, an English corruption of Deutsch, the word the immigrants used to describe themselves. Most German immigrants came from what is now southwestern Germany and included artisans and merchants, but the great majority were farmers and laborers. Economically, they represented middling folk, neither the poorest, who could not afford the trip, nor the better off, who did not want to leave. By the 1720s, Germans who had established themselves in the colonies wrote back to their friends, as one reported, quote, "Of the civil and religious liberties and privileges and of all the goodness I have heard and seen," end quote. Such letters convinced still more Germans to pull up stakes and embark for the Middle Colonies. Similar motives propelled the Scots-Irish, who considerably outnumbered German immigrants. The Scots-Irish actually hailed from Northern Ireland, Scotland, and Northern England. Like the Germans, the Scots-Irish were Protestants, but with a difference. Most German immigrants worshipped in Lutheran or German Reformed churches. Many others belonged to dissenting sects such as Mennonites, Moravians, and Amish, who sought relief from persecution for their refusal to bear arms and to swear oaths, practices they shared with the Quakers. In contrast, the Scots-Irish tended to be militant Presbyterians, who seldom hesitated to bear arms or swear oaths. Like German settlers, Scots-Irish immigrants were clannish, residing where they could among relatives or neighbors from the old country. In the 18th century, wave after wave of Scots-Irish immigrants arrived, culminating in a flood of immigration in the years just before the American Revolution. Deteriorating economic conditions in Northern Ireland, Scotland, and Northern England especially pushed many toward America. Most of the immigrants were farm laborers or tenant farmers fleeing droughts, crop failures, high food prices, or rising rents. They came, they told British officials, because of poverty, the tyranny of landlords, and their desire to do better in America. Both Scots-Irish and Germans probably heard the common saying, "Pennsylvania is a heaven for farmers and a paradise for artisans," but they almost certainly did not fully understand the risks of their decision to leave their native lands. Ship captains, aware of their hunger for labor in the colonies, eagerly signed up the penniless German immigrants as redemptioners, a variant of indentured servitude. A captain would agree to provide transportation to Philadelphia, where redemptioners would obtain the money to pay for their passage by borrowing it from a friend or relative who was already in the colonies, or, as most did, by selling themselves as servants. Many redemptioners traveled in family groups, unlike impoverished Scots-Irish immigrants, who usually traveled alone and paid for their passage by contracting as indentured servants before they sailed to the colonies. Redemptioners and indentured servants were packed aboard ships as closely as herring, one migrant observed. Seasickness, exhaustion, poverty, poor food, bad water, inadequate sanitation, and tight quarters encouraged the spread of disease. When one ship finally approached land, a passenger wrote, "Everyone crawls from below to the deck, and people cry for joy, pray, and sing praises and thanks to God." Unfortunately, their troubles were far from over. Unlike indentured servants, redemptioners negotiated independently with their purchasers about their period of servitude. Typically, a healthy adult redemptioner agreed to 4 years of labor. Indentured servants commonly served for 5, 6, or 7 years. An indentured servant wrote in 1743 that Pennsylvania was the best poor man's country in the world. Although masters often failed to live up to their promise to provide decent food and clothing, opportunity was abundant in the Middle Colonies because there was more work to do than workers to do it. Most servants toiled in Philadelphia, New York City, or one of the smaller towns and villages. Artisans, small manufacturers, and shopkeepers prized the labor of male servants. Female servants usually worked in households where nearly all of them cleaned, washed, cooked, or minded children. From the master's viewpoint, servants were a bargain. A master could purchase 5 or 6 years of a servant's labor for approximately the wages a common laborer would earn in 4 months. Since a slave cost about 3 times more than a servant, only prosperous colonists could afford the long-term investment in slave labor. Most farmers in the Middle Colonies used family labor, not slaves. Wheat, the most widely grown crop, did not require more labor than farmers could typically muster from relatives, neighbors, and a hired hand or two. Consequently, although people of African ancestry, almost all of them slaves, increased to more than 30,000 in the Middle Colonies by 1770, they accounted for only about 7% of the total population and much less outside the cities. Most slaves came to the Middle Colonies and New England after a stopover in the West Indies. Very few came directly from Africa. Slaves, unlike servants, could not charge masters with violating the terms of their contracts. Colonial laws punished slaves much more severely than servants for the same offense. Small numbers of slaves managed to obtain their freedom, but no African Americans escaped whites' firm convictions about black inferiority. Whites' racism and blacks' low social status made African Americans scapegoats for Euro-Americans' suspicions and anxieties. In 1741, when arson and several unexplained thefts plagued New York City, officials suspected a murderous slave conspiracy and executed 31 slaves on the basis of little evidence other than the slaves' refusal to conform fully to whites' expectations of servile behavior. City authorities burned 13 slaves at the stake and hanged 18 others. Although slaves were certainly impoverished, they were not among the poor for whom the middle colonies were reputed to be the best country in the world. Immigrants swarmed to the middle colonies because of the availability of land. The Penn family encouraged immigration to bring in potential buyers for their enormous tracts of land in Pennsylvania. From the beginning, Pennsylvania followed a policy of negotiating with Indian tribes to purchase additional land. This policy reduced the violent frontier clashes more common elsewhere in the colonies. Few colonists drifted beyond the northern boundaries of Pennsylvania. Owners of the huge estates in New York's Hudson Valley preferred to rent rather than sell their land, and therefore they attracted fewer immigrants. The Iroquois dominated the lucrative fur trade of the St. Lawrence Valley and eastern Great Lakes. They vigorously defended their territory from colonial encroachment, causing most settlers to prefer the comparatively safe lands of Pennsylvania. Since the cheapest land always lay at the margin of settlement, would-be farmers tended to migrate to promising areas just beyond already improved farms. By mid-century, settlement had reached the eastern slopes of the Appalachian Mountains, and newcomers spilled south down the fertile valley of the Shenandoah River into western Virginia and the Carolinas. Thousands of settlers migrated from the middle colonies through this back door to the south. Abraham Lincoln's great-grandfather, John Lincoln, whose own grandfather, Mordecai, had migrated from England to Massachusetts in the 1630s, moved his family in the 1760s from Pennsylvania down the Shenandoah Valley into Virginia, where the future president's grandfather, also named Abraham, raised his family, including the future president's father, Thomas Lincoln. Farmers like the Lincolns made the middle colonies the breadbasket of North America. They planted a wide variety of crops to feed their families, but they grew wheat in abundance. Flour milling was the number one industry and flour the number one export, accounting for about three-fourths of all exports from the middle colonies. Farmers profited from the grain market in the Atlantic world. By 1770, a bushel of wheat was worth twice as much, adjusted for inflation, as it had been in 1720. The steady rise of grain prices after 1720 helped make the standard of living in rural Pennsylvania higher than in any other agricultural region of the 18th century world. The comparatively widespread prosperity of all the middle colonies permitted residents to indulge in a half-century shopping spree for British imports. The middle colonies' per capita consumption of imported goods from Britain more than doubled between 1720 and 1770, far outstripping the per capita consumption of British goods in both New England and the southern colonies. Philadelphia stood at the crossroads of trade in wheat exports and British imports. Merchants occupied the top stratum of Philadelphia society. In a city where only 2% of the residents owned enough property to qualify to vote, merchants built grand homes and dominated local government. Many of Philadelphia's wealthiest merchants were Quakers. Quaker traits of industry, thrift, honesty, and sobriety encouraged the accumulation of wealth. The lower ranks of merchants included aspiring tradesmen such as Benjamin Franklin. In 1728, Franklin opened a small shop run mostly by his wife Deborah that sold a little of everything: cheese, codfish, coffee, goose feathers, soap, and occasionally a slave. In 1733, Franklin began to publish Poor Richard's Almanac, which preached the likelihood of long-term rewards for tireless labor. The almanac quickly became Franklin's most profitable product. Poor Richard's advice that God gives all things to industry might be considered the motto for the middle colonies, and the almanac is the source of many famous aphorisms, starting with, "Early to bed, early to rise makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise." "Fish and visitors stink after 3 days." "A penny saved is a penny earned." But here is my favorite: historians relate not so much what is done as what they would have believed. The promise of a worldly payoff made work a secular faith. Many Pennsylvanians thought less about the pearly gates of heaven than about their pocketbooks. Although Quakers remained influential in Pennsylvania, Franklin spoke for most colonists with his down-to-earth advice about work, discipline, and thrift that celebrated the spark of ambition and the promise of worldly gain. Between 1700 and 1770, the population of the southern colonies of Virginia, Maryland, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia grew almost ninefold. By 1770, about twice as many people lived in the South as in either the Middle Colonies or New England. As elsewhere, natural increase in immigration accounted for the rapid population growth. Many Scots-Irish and German immigrants funneled from the Middle Colonies into the Southern backcountry. Other immigrants were indentured servants, mostly English and Scots-Irish. But slaves made the most striking contribution to the booming Southern colonies, transforming the racial composition of the population. Slavery came to define the Southern colonies during the 18th century, shaping the region's economy, society, and politics. The numbers of Southerners of African ancestry, nearly all of them slaves, rocketed from just over 20,000 in 1700 to well over 400,000 in 1770. The black population increased nearly three times faster than the South's briskly growing white population. Consequently, the proportion of Southerners of African ancestry grew from 20% in 1700 to 40% in 1770. Southern colonists clustered in two geographic and agricultural zones. The colonies in the Upper South, surrounding Chesapeake Bay, specialized in growing tobacco as they had since the early 17th century. Throughout the 18th century, 9 out of 10 Southern whites and 8 out of 10 Southern blacks lived in the Chesapeake region. The Upper South retained a white majority during the 18th century. In the Lower South, a much smaller cluster of colonists inhabited the coastal region and specialized in the production of rice and indigo, a plant used to make blue dye. Lower South colonists made up only 5% of the total population of the Southern colonies in 1700, but inched upward to 15% by 1770. South Carolina was the sole British colony along the southern Atlantic coast until 1732. North Carolina, founded in 1711 and 1712, was largely an extension of the Chesapeake region. Georgia was founded in 1732 as a refuge for poor people from England. Georgia's leaders banned slavery from 1735 to 1750, but few settlers arrived until after Georgia lifted the prohibition on slavery after 1750 and slaves were imported in large numbers. In South Carolina, in contrast to Georgia and every other British mainland colony, slaves outnumbered whites almost 2-1. In rice-growing regions along the South Carolina coast, the ratio of blacks to whites was greater than 10-1. The enormous growth in the South's slave population occurred through natural increase and the Atlantic slave trade. Slave ships brought almost 300,000 Africans to British North America between 1619 and 1780. Of these Africans, 95% arrived in the South and 96% arrived during the 18th century. Unlike indentured servants and redemptioners, these Africans did not choose to come to the colonies. Most of them had been born into free families located within a few hundred miles of the West African coast. Although they shared African origins, they came from many different African cultures, such as Akan, Angolan, Asante, Bambara, Gambian, Igbo, and Mandinga, among others. They spoke different languages, worshipped different deities, observed different rules of kinship, grew different crops, and recognized different rulers. The most important experience they had in common was enslavement. Captured in war, kidnapped, or sold into slavery by other Africans, they were brought to the coast, sold to African traders who assembled slaves for resale, and sold again to European or colonial ship captains who packed 200 to 300 or more aboard ships that carried them on the Middle Passage across the Atlantic, and then sold them yet again to colonial slave merchants or southern planters. European slavers often chafed against the powerful African middlemen from whom they purchased their human cargo, but it was foolhardy to attempt to bypass them. One who did organized a raiding expedition into the interior of present-day Gabon, but lacking knowledge of the land, they wandered into hostile territory and were attacked by locals who killed half the party. The captain was grazed in the rear by a poison-tipped arrow, and the raiding party barely made it back to safety. The captain nearly died and further suffered the temporary suspension of his slave trading contract for his folly. Olaudah de Equiano published an account of his enslavement that reveals the common experiences of millions of other Africans swept up in the slave trade. In 1756, when he was 11 years old, Africans kidnapped Equiano in what is now Nigeria. They sold him to other Africans, who in turn eventually sold him to a slave ship on the coast. Once the ship set sail, many of the slaves, crowded together in suffocating heat, fouled by filth of all descriptions, died from sickness. The shrieks of the women and the groans of the dying rendered the whole a scene of horror almost inconceivable, Equiano recalled. Most of the slaves on the ship were sold in Barbados, but Equiano and other leftovers were shipped off to Virginia. Most of the slaves on the ship were sold in Barbados, but Equiano and other leftovers were shipped off to Virginia, where the captain of a tobacco ship bound for England purchased Equiano, and he traveled as an enslaved sailor between North America, England, and the West Indies for 10 years until he succeeded in buying his freedom in 1766. Only about 15% of the slaves brought into the southern colonies came aboard ships from the West Indies, as Equiano did. All the other slaves brought into the southern colonies came directly from Africa, and almost all the ships that brought them, roughly 90%, belonged to British merchants. Most of the slaves on board were young adults, with men usually outnumbering women 2 to 1. Children under the age of 14, like Equiano, typically accounted for no more than 10 to 15% of cargo. The death rate during the Middle Passage varied greatly from ship to ship. On average, about 15% of the slaves died, but sometimes half or more perished. The average death rate among the white crew of slave ships was often nearly as bad. In general, the longer the voyage lasted, the more people died. Slaves and crew succumbed not only to epidemic diseases, such as smallpox and dysentery, but also to acute dehydration caused by fluid loss from perspiration, vomiting, and diarrhea, combined with a severe shortage of drinking water. Normally, at any one time, an individual planter bought a relatively small number of newly arrived Africans, or new Negroes as they were called. Planters expected their other slaves, either those born into slavery in the colonies, often called country-born or Creole slaves, or Africans who had arrived earlier, to help new arrivals become accustomed to their strange new surroundings. Planters' preferences for slaves from specific regions of Africa aided slaves' acculturation, or seasoning as it was then called, to the routine of bondage in the southern colonies. Chesapeake planters preferred slaves from Senegambia, the Gold Coast, or, like Equiano, the Bight of Biafra, which together accounted for about 40% of Africans imported to the Chesapeake. South Carolina planters favored slaves from the Central African Congo and Angola regions, the origins of about 40% of the slaves they imported. Although slaves spoke many different languages, enough linguistic and cultural similarities existed that they could usually communicate with other Africans from the same region. New Africans had to adjust to the physical as well as the cultural environment of the southern colonies. Slaves who had just endured the Middle Passage were poorly nourished, weak, and sick. In this vulnerable state, they encountered the alien diseases of North America without having developed a biological arsenal of acquired immunities. As many as 10 to 15% of newly arrived Africans died during their first year in the southern colonies. Still, the large number of newly enslaved Africans made the influence of African culture in the South stronger in the 18th century than ever before. While newly enslaved Africans poured into the southern colonies, slave mothers bore children, which caused the slave population in the South to grow rapidly. Slave owners encouraged these births. The ever-present risk of being separated by sale also brought grief to many slave families. Nonetheless, the growing number of slave children set the southern colonies apart from other New World slave societies, particularly the West Indian Sugar Islands, where death rates were so high that deaths were greater than births. The high birth rate in the southern colonies meant that by the 1740s, despite the arrival of newly enslaved Africans, the majority of southern slaves were born in the colonies. Southern planters expected slaves to work from sunup to sundown and beyond. The conflict between the master's desire for maximum labor and the slave's reluctance to do more than necessary made the threat of physical punishment a constant for 18th century slaves. Masters preferred black slaves to white indentured servants because slaves served for life and because colonial laws did not limit the force masters could use against slaves. Enslaved people often resisted their masters' demands, one traveler noted, because of their greatness of soul, their stubborn unwillingness to conform to their masters' definition of them as merely slaves. Some slaves escalated their acts of resistance to direct physical confrontation with the master, the mistress, or an overseer. But a hoe raised in anger, a punch in the face, or a desperate swipe with a knife led to swift and predictable retaliation by whites. Throughout the southern colonies, the balance of physical power rested securely in the hands of whites. Rebellion occurred, however, at Stono, South Carolina in 1739. A group of about 20 slaves attacked a country store, killed the two shopkeepers, and took the store's guns, ammunition, and powder. The rebels plundered and burned several plantations and killed more than 20 white men, women, and children. A mounted force of whites quickly put down the rebellion. They placed the rebels' heads atop mileposts along the main road to Charlestown, grim reminders of the consequences of rebellion. The South Carolina legislature enacted a harsh slave code in 1740 to punish with the utmost severity the enslaved. The Stono Rebellion illustrated that 18th century slaves had no chance of overturning slavery and very little chance of defending themselves in any bold strike for freedom. No other similar uprisings occurred during the colonial period. Slaves maneuvered constantly to protect themselves and to gain a measure of autonomy within the boundaries of slavery. In Chesapeake tobacco fields, most slaves were subject to close supervision by whites. In the Lower South, the task system gave slaves some control over the pace of their work and some choice in the use of their time. A task was typically defined as a certain area of ground to be cultivated or a specific job to be completed. A slave who completed the assigned task might use the remainder of the day, if any, to work in a garden, fish, hunt, spin, weave, sew, cook, or even work for wages outside the plantation. When masters sought to boost productivity by increasing tasks, slaves did what they could to defend their customary assignments. 18th century slaves also planted the roots of African American lineages that branch out to the present. Slaves valued family ties, and as in the West African societies, kinship structured slaves' relations with one another. Slave parents often gave a child the name of a grandparent, aunt, or uncle. In West Africa, kinship identified a person's place among living relatives and linked the person backward to ancestors in the past and forward to descendants in the future. Newly imported African slaves usually arrived alone, like Equiano, without kin. Often slaves who had traversed the Middle Passage on the same ship adopted one another as brothers and sisters. Likewise, as new Negroes were seasoned and incorporated into existing slave communities, established families often adopted them into new kinship networks. When possible, slaves expressed many other features of their West African origins in their lives on New World plantations. They gave their children African names such as Cujo, Quash, Minda, or Fuladi. They grew food crops they had known in Africa, such as yams and okra. They constructed huts with mud walls and thatched roofs similar to African residences. They fashioned banjos, drums, and other musical instruments, held dances, and observed funeral rites that echoed African practices. In these and many other ways, slaves drew upon their African heritages as much as the oppressive circumstances of slavery permitted. Slaves' labor bestowed prosperity on their masters, British merchants, and the monarchy. Slavery was so important and valuable that one minister claimed in 1757 that to live in Virginia without slaves is morally impossible. The southern colonies supplied 90% of all North American exports to Britain. Rice exports from the lower south exploded from less than 500,000 pounds in 1700 to 80,000,000 pounds in 1770, nearly all of it grown by slaves. Exports of indigo also boomed. Together, rice and indigo made up 3/4 of exports from the lower south, nearly 2/3 of them going to Britain and most of the rest to the West Indies, where sugar-growing slaves ate slave-grown rice. Tobacco was by far the most important export from British North America. By 1770, it represented almost 1/3 of total colonial exports and 3/4 of all Chesapeake exports. Under the provisions of the Navigation Acts, nearly all tobacco went to Britain, where the monarchy collected a lucrative tax on each pound. British merchants then re-exported more than 80% of the tobacco to the European continent, pocketing a nice markup for their troubles. These products of slave labor made the southern colonies by far the richest in North America. The per capita wealth of free whites in the South was four times greater than that in New England and three times that in the middle colonies. At the top of the wealth pyramid stood the rice grandees of the lower South and the tobacco gentry of the Chesapeake. These elite families commonly resided on large estates in handsome mansions adorned by luxurious gardens, all maintained and supported by slaves. The vast differences in wealth among white Southerners caused envy and occasional tension between rich and poor, but remarkably little open hostility. In private, the planter elite belittled humble whites, but in public, the planters claimed their lesser neighbors were equals in belonging to the superior, in their minds, white race. Looking upward, white yeomen and tenants, who owned neither land nor slaves, sensed the gentry's condescension and barely hidden contempt. But they also appreciated the gentry for granting favors, upholding white supremacy, and keeping slaves in their place. Although racial slavery made a few whites much richer than others, it also gave those who did not get rich a powerful reason to feel similar in race to those who were so different in wealth. The slaveholding gentry dominated the politics and economy of the southern colonies. Voters elected members of the gentry to serve in the colonial legislature. The gentry passed elected political offices from generation to generation almost as if they were hereditary. Politically, the gentry built a self-perpetuating oligarchy, ruled by the elite few, with the votes of their many humble neighbors. The gentry also set the cultural standard in the southern colonies. They entertained lavishly, gambled regularly, and attended the Anglican church services more for social than for religious reasons. Above all, they cultivated the leisurely pursuit of happiness. They did not condone idleness, however. Their many pleasures and responsibilities as plantation owners kept them busy. Thomas Jefferson, a phenomenally productive member of the gentry, recalled that his earliest childhood memory was of being carried on a pillow by a family slave, a powerful image of the slave hands supporting the gentry's leisure and achievement. The societies of New England, the Middle Colonies, and the Southern Colonies became quite different from each other during the 18th century. But colonists throughout British North America also shared experiences that set them apart from residents of the Spanish and French colonies. The first was economic. All three British colonial regions had their economic roots in agriculture. Colonists sold their products in markets that, in turn, offered a more or less uniform set of goods to consumers throughout British North America. Another unifying experience was a decline in the importance of religion to daily life. Some settlers called for a revival of religious intensity, but most people focused less on religion and more on the affairs of the world than they had in the 17th century. Also, white inhabitants throughout British North America became aware that they shared a distinctive identity as British colonists. 13 different governments presided over these North American colonies, but all of them answered to the British monarchy. British policies governed not only trade, but also military and diplomatic relations with the Indians, French, and Spanish along colonial borderlands. Royal officials who expected loyalty from the colonists often had difficulty obtaining obedience. The British colonists asserted their rights and privileges as British subjects to defend their own special colonial interests. 18th century commerce whetted colonials' appetite to consume. Colonial products spurred the development of mass markets throughout the Atlantic world. Huge increases in the supply of colonial tobacco and sugar brought the prices of these small luxuries within the reach of most free whites. Colonial goods taught an important lesson of 18th century commerce. Ordinary people, not just the wealthy elite, bought things that they desired, not just what they absolutely needed. Even news, formerly restricted mostly to a few people through face-to-face conversations or private letters, became an object of consumption with the innovation of newspapers and the rise in literacy among whites. With the ample supplies and low prices, market demand seemed nearly unlimited. The Atlantic commerce that took colonial goods to markets in Britain brought objects of consumer desire back to the colonies. British merchants and manufacturers recognized that colonists made excellent customers, and the Navigation Acts gave British exporters privileged access to the colonial market. By mid-century, export-oriented industries in Britain were growing 10 times faster than firms that catered to the home market. When the colonists' eagerness to consume exceeded their ability to pay, British exporters extended credit, and colonial debts soared. Imported mirrors, silverware, spices, bed and table linens, clocks, tea services, wigs, books, and more found their way into parlors, kitchens, and bedrooms throughout the colonies. Despite the many differences among the colonists, the consumption of similar British exports built a certain uniformity of goods across region, religion, class, and status. The colonial white middle and upper classes identified themselves as British not just because of the shared dominant culture with the home islands of Britain, but superficially through the things they bought. Historian T.H. Breen identified this process of Anglicization in which Americans who could afford to do so, and many others who could only do so through the extension of generous terms of credit, wore clothing manufactured in England, used dishware and silverware made in England, drank British East India Company tea from china sets manufactured in England, and strove to emulate British architecture in their buildings, elite British mannerisms in their daily comportment, and devoured British books, magazines, and newspapers to learn as much as possible about the mother country. The standard of living for many white Americans improved over the course of the 18th century, but mainly just for those of what contemporaries called the middling sort, meaning skilled artisans, small shopkeepers, clergymen, college professors, and private tutors, to say nothing, of course, of the elites. Yeoman farmers, those who only owned or leased less than 250 acres of land, also saw modest gains in the quality of their material lives. Elite Americans, though, saw substantial improvement in their material lives over the course of the 18th century, and the built environment of the colonial cities vividly reflects the overall wealth of the colonies. Take, for example, the 17th century New England meeting house that you saw in the previous lecture. You can see that the architecture is quite basic, in keeping with Puritan simplicity, but also because the numbers of skilled carpenters were fairly small around the year 1650. Glass was very expensive, and so the windows are necessarily very small and let in relatively little light. Look inside, and you see a high degree of austerity and simplicity. Now, look at what has changed 100 years later, and here we have a view of Boston's Old South Church built around the year 1750, and the differences are striking. For one, it's a lot bigger, meaning that Boston's population was much larger than it was in 1650. Its architecture is beautiful and ornate, though still somewhat keeping with Georgian elegance and simplicity. Instead of being made exclusively of wood, this one heavily features red brick, has a tall steeple with the latest in mechanical clocks, and the wood is sculpted and painted. See how big the windows are, meaning that expensive English glass is now much more affordable. Americans could make their own glass, but were prevented from making high-quality glass that you would want for your church or your manor house. Go inside, and you see how light and spacious the sanctuary is, with the big windows letting in lots of light. The pulpit is more highly elevated than its 1650 predecessor, and ornately decorated with sculpted and painted wood. Here we have a view of a row of upper-class houses in central Philadelphia, and you see the same kind of painted wood and red brick, large windows, and elegant decorations. The interiors of elite houses were as ornate as the colonial gentry could afford, but even so, they were still impressive, boasting several rooms, two or even three floors of living space, fine furnishings manufactured preferably in England, a small library of books to suggest the residents' intellectual refinement, and art objects. The vast majority of white Americans, however, lived in rural areas and in considerably simpler houses comprised of just one chamber with a sleeping loft above the main living area accessed by a ladder or narrow staircase. A fireplace served as both heat source and cooking space, and furnishings were limited to a single table and a few chairs or benches. City dwellers mostly lived in small rented houses or single rooms in boarding houses while artisans lived in quarters situated above their workshops, and most merchants lived in a similar fashion. The dazzling variety of imported consumer goods also presented women and men with a novel array of choices. In many respects, the choices might appear trivial, whether to buy knives and forks, teacups, a mirror, or a clock. But such small choices confronted 18th century consumers with a big question. What do you want? As colonial consumers defined and expressed their desires with greater frequency during the 18th century, they became accustomed to thinking of themselves as individuals who had the power to make decisions that influenced the quality of their lives. 18th century colonists could choose from almost as many religions as consumer goods. Almost all of the many religious denominations represented some form of Christianity, nearly all of them Protestant. Roman Catholics concentrated in Maryland as they had since the 17th century, but even they were far outnumbered by Protestants, while a very small handful of Jews lived in a few of the coastal cities. The varieties of Protestant faith and practice ranged across a broad spectrum. The middle colonies and the southern backcountry included militant Baptists and Presbyterians. Huguenots, who had fled persecution in Catholic France, peopled congregations in several cities. In New England, old-style Puritanism splintered into strands of Congregationalism that differed over fine points of Calvinist theology. The Congregational Church was the official established church in most New England colonies, and all residents paid taxes for its support. Throughout the plantation South and in urban centers such as Charleston, New York, and Philadelphia, prominent colonists belonged to the Anglican Church, which received tax support in the South. But dissenting faiths grew everywhere, and in most colonies, their believers won the right to worship publicly, although established churches retained official legal and financial support. Many educated colonists became deists, looking for God's plan in nature more than in the Bible. Deism shared the ideas of 18th century European Enlightenment thinkers, who tended to agree that science and reason could disclose God's laws in the natural order. In the colonies as well as in Europe, Enlightenment ideas encouraged people to study the world around them, to think for themselves, and to ask whether the disorderly appearance of things masked the principles of a deeper natural order. Leading thinkers such as Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson communicated with each other, seeking both to understand nature and to find ways to improve society. Franklin's interest in electricity, stoves, and eyeglasses typified the shift of focus among many 18th century colonists from heaven to the here and now. Most 18th century colonists went to church seldom or not at all, although they probably considered themselves Christians. A minister in Charleston observed that on the Sabbath, the taverns have more visitants than the churches. In the leading colonial cities, church members were a small minority. Anglican parishes in the South rarely claimed more than one-fifth of adults as members. In some regions of rural New England and the middle colonies, two-thirds of adults belonged to churches, while elsewhere only one-quarter of residents went to church. The dominant faith overall was religious indifference. As a late 18th century traveler observed, quote, "Religious indifference is imperceptibly disseminated from one end of the continent to the other," end quote. The spread of religious indifference, of deism, of rivalry among Protestant denominations, and of comfortable backsliding greatly concerned many Christians. A few despaired that, as one wrote, "religion lay a-dying and ready to expire its last breath of life." To combat what one preacher called the dead formality of church services, some ministers set out to convert non-believers and to revive the piety of the faithful with a new style of preaching that appealed more to the heart than to the head. Historians have termed this wave of revivals the First Great Awakening. In Massachusetts during the mid-1730s, the fiery Puritan minister Jonathan Edwards reaped a harvest of souls by emphasizing traditional Puritan doctrines of humanity's utter depravity and God's vengeful omnipotence. In Pennsylvania and New Jersey, William Tennant and his son William Tennant Jr. led revivals that dramatized spiritual rebirth with accounts of God's miraculous powers. The most famous revivalist in the 18th century Atlantic world was George Whitefield. An Anglican, Whitefield preached well-worn messages of sin and salvation to large audiences in England using his spellbinding, unforgettable voice. Whitfield visited the North American colonies 7 times, staying for more than 3 years during the mid-1740s and attracting tens of thousands to his sermons, including Benjamin Franklin and Alauda Equiano. Whitfield's preaching transported many in his audience to emotion-choked states of religious ecstasy, as he wrote, with, quote, "most lifting their eyes to heaven and crying to God for mercy," end quote. Whitfield's revival spawned many lesser imitations. Itinerant preachers, many of them poorly educated, roamed the colonial backcountry after mid-century. Bathsheba Kingsley, a member of Jonathan Edwards's flock, preached the revival message informally, as did an unprecedented number of other women throughout the colonies, causing Edwards's congregation to brand her a brawling woman who had gone quite out of her place. The revivals awakened and refreshed the spiritual energies of thousands of colonists struggling with the uncertainties and anxieties of 18th century America in complete transition. The conversions at the revivals did not substantially boost the total number of church members, however. After the revivalists moved on, the routines and pressures of everyday existence reasserted their priority in the lives of many converts. But the revivals expressed the important message that every soul mattered, that men and women could choose to be saved, that individuals had the power to make a decision for everlasting life or death. Colonial revivals expressed in religious terms many of the same democratic and egalitarian values expressed in economic terms by colonists' patterns of consumption. One colonist noted the analogy by referring to itinerant revivalists as, quote-unquote, peddlers in divinity. Like consumption, revivals contributed to a set of common experiences that bridged colonial divides of faith, region, class, and status. One thing about the awakening that tends to be overlooked is its impact upon African Americans. Prior to the 1730s, slave owners actively discouraged Christian missionaries from proselytizing among their slaves for fear that Christian conversion might force them to emancipate the newly converted or render their slaves unruly or insolent. For their part, many Africans especially had no interest in a religion that justified their subjugation and enslavement. Some Anglican missionaries had success in converting slaves in the early 18th century, but it was a highly constricted faith in which blacks and whites were kept segregated in worship services, and parsons constantly emphasized to slaves that their condition, not just their enslavement, but their inherent racial inferiority to whites, is mandated by God, and that they must accept this and seek liberation only in death. Anglican worship is a tightly regimented performance that many African converts found difficult to relate to, and when New Light proselytes began going into slave communities, their emphasis upon highly emotional and exuberant worship found much greater appeal from potential converts. Baptists, who preferred to baptize in natural bodies of water, sometimes involving complete immersion, resonated with those West Africans who remembered their native religions that focused upon water as a purifying substance into which one must immerse oneself. Baptists also encouraged mixed worship services, encouraged black men to preach and have authority in such churches, with the result that large numbers of African Americans gravitated toward evangelical Protestantism. Some radical Baptists even went so far as to question the morality of slavery, but this tended to galvanize Anglican and Presbyterian opposition to that denomination and to evangelicalism in general. The important point to emphasize here is that African Americans took a Christianity that was supposed to uphold white superiority and the institution of their enslavement and turned it into something uniquely their own, and one which gave them a vocabulary to challenge slavery and white supremacy that one can still hear in the speeches of Dr. Martin Luther King. Although colonial wars of the mid-century decades took away some attention from the revivals, they did continue through the 1750s and 1760s and came to define American Protestant Christianity in ways that are still familiar today. Let us now turn our attention to Indian country. As Indian societies reacted to foreign religious ideas, labor and economic systems, educational institutions, and trade currencies, colonists in turn observed and adopted certain native ways of life. France's North American Empire constituted a veneer of French population and culture spread thinly over an Indian world. Indian converts and customers were attracted to French missions and trading posts, and French traders, priests, soldiers, and agents ventured into Indian country to bolster Indian allegiance, but the French population remained relatively small and scattered in settlements from the mouth of the St. Lawrence to the mouth of the Mississippi. Nevertheless, in regions such as Louisiana, French settlers and Indians intermarried, exchanged foods, commodities, and knowledge, and, along with African slaves, built networks of cross-cultural exchange through individual face-to-face interactions. Many Europeans who pushed into Indian country adopted Indian ways, which suited their new environment and eased their interactions with native populations. They hunted using Indian techniques, dressed in Indian hunting shirts, leggings, and moccasins, wore their hair Indian style, wore body paint and tattoos, spoke Indian languages, and smoked Indian pipes. One fur trader who lived and worked among the Ojibwe Indians in northwestern Canada recorded in his journal, quote, "This night dreamed in the Chippewyan language for the first time," end quote. In 1650, Connecticut made it illegal for colonists to go and live among Indians, clear evidence that some were doing so. Colonial authorities sometimes became alarmed by the numbers of citizens who went Indian. Some individuals chose to live with Indians and even fought beside them against Europeans. Indians also took hundreds of captives from European settlements during the colonial wars, adopting them into their societies and turning them from enemies into relatives. Some of these captives became so accustomed to life in Indian country and Indian communities that they stayed permanently, even refusing opportunities to return home. Benjamin Franklin said that Europeans who had lived in Indian societies and then returned to colonial societies soon, quote, "became disgusted with our manner of life," end quote. For long periods over large areas of America, Indians and Europeans coexisted closely, interacting with and adjusting to each other's presence and culture, and sometimes taking on aspects of one another's identity and way of life. The intimate familiarity that was characteristic of many frontier societies in 18th century America made fighting all the more bitter when wars broke out between former neighbors. Trade in animal hides was a major component of the economy of early America. Pelts from beavers trapped in Canada and the northern British colonies were extremely valuable in Europe, where wearing fur provided warmth and social prestige. Farther south, deer skins, originating in the interior and shipped out of Charleston to European tanners, were equally sought after. Metal tools, weapons, and utensils, woven cloth, and other European goods exchanged for furs were equally valuable to Indians. But Europeans and Indians in colonial America trafficked in human beings as well as in animal pelts. Some Indian societies kept slaves before European contact, usually captives taken in war. But with conflict escalating and demands for labor increasing, more and more Indian people raided for slaves, held slaves, or became slaves themselves. Swedes, Dutch, French, British, Spaniards, Russians, and Americans all participated in the pelt trade. In Alaska, Russian traders began to hunt for sea otter pelts after Vitus Bering, a Dane in the Tsar's service who gave his name to the straits, reached the Aleutian Islands in 1741. Before the end of the century, ships from several European nations and from New England were plying the coastline from Oregon to Alaska, trading for sea otter pelts that they then transported across the Pacific and sold at great profits in China. The search for new sources of furs and new customers fueled continued European exploration and penetration of Indian country. Many individual and family fortunes were built on the production and marketing of beaver and deer skins, and trading posts became centers of cultural as well as economic interaction. The fur trade was part of everyday life in early America, and it continued for centuries. The Hudson's Bay Company, established by British Royal Charter in 1670, joked that its initials stood for "Here Before Christ." Many North American cities, including Montreal, St. Louis, Detroit, Charleston, Albany, and New York City, began as fur or deerskin trade markets. Europeans provided capital, organization, manufactured goods, and equipment for the trade. Indians provided much of the labor force. They hunted the animals, guided the fur traders, and paddled the canoes that carried pelts to market. Indian women prepared the skins. Various Indian groups acted as middlemen, securing lucrative roles by conveying pelts and manufactured goods between Europeans and more distant tribes. Indian women played a valuable role as cultural mediators. They lived with and frequently married European traders, translated for them, and provided them with access to the kinship networks of Indian societies. The children of these unions often grew up to become influential leaders in Indian communities and skilled negotiators with colonial societies. In areas of Canada and around the Great Lakes, Indian women who married French traders played a central role in the fur trade, operating as brokers between Indian and European society and linking Indian country to an expanding transatlantic economy. They and their husbands produced a new population known as Métis, built kinship networks that were Catholic as well as indigenous, and created communities that remained long after France officially withdrew from the area. In tribes where clan descent followed the father's line, children of European traders might lack a place in their Indian mother's society. But in matrilineal societies, children of mixed ancestry inherited their mother's clan and community. By the 18th century, it was not uncommon to find Creek and Cherokee Indians in the southeast who bore the Scottish surnames of the traders who fathered them, McIntosh, McGillivray, Ross, or MacDonald, for example, and who inherited their clan and tribal identity intact from their mothers. Such individuals often acted as intermediaries between colonial and Indian societies, became influential in their tribes, and introduced European ways of thinking about land, trade, and property. In return for the pelts they supplied and the services they provided, Indians obtained steel knives and axes, firearms, metal cooking vessels, woolen blankets and clothing, glass beads, mirrors, scissors, awls, spoons, linen shirts, hats, buckles, and a host of other goods. The new items sometimes replaced traditional ones. Metal axes were better than stone ones. Sometimes they simply supplemented existing items. Birch bark containers continue to be used for maple sugaring long after copper kettles were introduced. Sometimes Indians refashioned the new items in traditional ways. Metal pots might be cut up for jewelry. Some items cheaply produced in European factories and traded as trinkets and tools took on a social and spiritual significance once they entered Indian hands. For northeastern Algonquin peoples, glass beads and metal objects were often identified with native crystal and copper, both of which possessed special healthful properties. All told, the costs of the fur trade to Indians were enormous. Contagious diseases spread from tribe to tribe as Indians traded with Europeans and then with other Indians. Overhunting depleted animal populations to the point of extinction in some regions and undermined traditional hunting rituals and reciprocal relationships in which hunters treated animal spirits with respect and animals allowed themselves to be hunted. New tools made life easier, but traditional craft skills sometimes declined. Competition for new weapons made warfare more common. The new weapons themselves made warfare more lethal. Balanced and diversified patterns of subsistence were disrupted as communities focused their energies on hunting and trapping to meet the insatiable demands of European fur markets. Indian people in some areas traded for European goods but resisted being pulled into a dependent relationship on traders. Others became heavily dependent on European goods. As native environments became degraded, subsistence patterns changed, and Indian people became increasingly dependent on Europeans for goods, clothing, and food. Europeans, in turn, sought to bring native resources, land, and labor into the market. Indians were becoming tied to developing European capitalism as both producers and consumers and being incorporated into a world market. They fell into debt to European traders who offered credit, then sometimes demanded land in payment for accumulated debts, and traders brought alcohol into Indian country. Alcohol was a crucial commodity for European traders. It could be transported easily in concentrated form and diluted for sale at huge profits, and it was quickly consumed. Traders soon found that liquor was a good way of attracting Indians to trade and then getting them to make that trade on favorable terms. Not all Indian people drank, and not all who did suffered from it, but alcohol had disastrous effects on many Indian societies. Indian hunters who sold their catch for a bottle of rum often left their families in poverty. Drunken brawls disrupted social relations in communities that traditionally stressed harmony and helped between individuals and families. Scholars and clinicians still do not fully understand the exact causes and nature of alcoholism. Like other people, Indians who drank to excess did so for a variety of social, cultural, genetic, and behavioral reasons. Some drank because they enjoyed the sensations alcohol produced. Some sought solace in alcohol as they were forced to adjust to the radical changes to their ways of life. Indian leaders throughout colonial America complained about the rum trade and asked that it be halted, but colonial governments could not or would not stem the tide of alcohol into Indian villages. Slavery existed in North America long before the English shipped the first African slaves to Jamestown in 1619. Before contact with Europeans, Indian warriors often took their enemies captive rather than killing them. They carried off war captives as slaves, humiliated and held them in subordination as markers of prowess in battle, gave them as gifts while making alliances, and sometimes adopted them in place of deceased relatives. But European colonialism introduced different concepts of slavery, brought new slave peoples to America from Africa, and drove Indian slave raiding to unprecedented levels. Like the trade in furs, trade in Indian slaves became a routine feature of the developing Atlantic economy. Indian hunters of human flesh, like Indian hunters of animal pelts, ranged farther afield and increased their catch to meet new demands. All European colonies in America used Indian slaves. The indigenous tradition of taking war captives and the European tradition of purchasing humans as property came together to shape a new slave market. In the shatter zone generated by Spanish invasion in the colonial South, competition for trade, escalating warfare, slave raiding, and epidemic disease were all interconnected. The English founded Charleston, South Carolina in 1670 and quickly began shipping in African slaves and shipping out Indian slaves to the Caribbean. Indians exchanged slaves for guns, which they then turned on Indian enemies to take more slaves. It was a perilous strategy, and one to which slave-raiding tribes themselves often fell victim. Westo Indians, originally a group of Eries who had fled Iroquois attacks in the north and moved to the James River, began slave-raiding to supply English slave traders at Jamestown. By the 1660s, they were raiding for slaves even farther south, in Georgia and Florida. Armed with English guns, the Westos preyed on bow and arrow tribes for slaves to sell in Charleston until they themselves were destroyed in 1682 by Shawnee Indians in the pay of Carolina traders. The Westos in turn became victims of the Indian slave trade. By the end of the 17th century, French movement down the Mississippi and westward penetration of English traders from Charleston brought guns and slave raiding to the lower Mississippi Valley. Newly armed bands of Indians raided villages on both sides of the Mississippi for slaves, whom they sold to English traders. The traders marched the slaves east to be used in colonial households and on plantations or to be shipped to the Caribbean. The Chickasaws emerged as the dominant slave traders in the region. Pierre Lemoine d'Iberville, the founder of France's Louisiana colony, reported in 1699 that the Chickasaws, quote, were going among all the other nations to make war on them and to carry off as many slaves as they could, whom they buy and use in extensive trading to the distress of all these Indian nations, end quote. Chickasaw raiding parties crossed the Mississippi and then herded their captives east to Charleston, causing reverberations throughout the lower Mississippi Valley as other Indians fell victim, migrated, or sought refuge with other tribes. As with the fur trade, the Indian slave trade and the violence associated with it helped spread European diseases. Slave raiders who had come in contact with Europeans and their germs ranged far and wide through Indian country. Refugees from their raids huddled together in communities, prime targets for lethal new epidemics. Disease hit populations already disrupted, displaced, weakened, and malnourished by the changes that followed in the wake of colonialism. The great southeastern smallpox epidemic of 1696 to 1700 broke out among English and African populations that were in frequent contact with Indians and spread via South Carolina's Indian trading allies to the Mississippi Valley and the Gulf Coast. Some historians estimate that the deadly combination of smallpox and rum reduced the Indian population living within 200 miles of the English settlements to less than one-sixth of its original size within 50 years. The population collapse led to war in 1715 between South Carolina and its former Yamasee allies, who were indebted to colonial traders but could no longer supply the number of slaves South Carolina demanded, and who now adopted more captives to bolster their own declining population. Before 1715, English colonists had captured, sold, and enslaved an estimated 30 to 50,000 Indians, but now the flow of Indian captives into Charleston slowed to a trickle, and South Carolina turned to imports of African slaves to supply its labor needs. In some areas, Africans came to outnumber Europeans, and the new people Indians encountered as a result of European colonialism were more likely to be black than white. Later in the 18th century, Indians, for whom the age and gender of captives had traditionally determined their suitability for seizure and treatment as slaves, began to target African Americans and to adopt racial attitudes toward slavery. By the turn of the century, many Indian people held African slaves regarded them much as their white neighbors did. In New France, Indian traders sold or gave captives to Frenchmen, sometimes as gifts to cement and maintain their commercial and military alliances with France. French and Indian traders sold many slaves to the English in Carolina and transferred others to Quebec and Montreal, where they might serve in French households or get shipped to the Caribbean. Illinois raiders ranged out across the prairies, taking captives as slaves and trading them to the Ottawas and other tribes for guns and metal weapons. So many Indians were captured from the eastern plains that French slaveholders called almost all Indian slaves Pawnee, whether or not they were actually Pawnees. As Indian slaves passed from Indian to French hands, two forms of slavery overlapped and altered. The French adjusted to giving and receiving Indian slaves as a means of sustaining alliances and trade, and Indian slave raiders responded to the lure of French markets and money. Throughout most of North America, Indian peoples followed their ancient cycles of life without disruption, participated in ceremonies to keep crops growing, game plentiful, and the universe in harmony, and lived, fought, and traded with other Indians, not with Europeans. But European people, European animals, and European diseases were infiltrating North America. Europeans were a permanent presence, and colonial America was being established in Indian America. When Europeans went into Indian country to conduct business, they entered a world crisscrossed by exchange networks between communities and between cultures, where the constant renewal of alliances and good relations was vital to avoiding violence. Gift exchanges lay at the heart of Indian relations with other Indians, and they became equally important in Indian relations with the Spanish, French, and English. Different peoples attached different meanings to gifts, and Europeans had to learn that such exchanges were not conducted solely for profit, but involved social, political, and even spiritual aspects as well as economic incentives. Indians and Europeans who endeavored to deal with each other across cultural gulfs had to negotiate a collision and confluence of worldviews. In doing so, they forged uniquely American forms of diplomacy. France's North American empire, huge in extent but sparsely populated, depended on maintaining the goodwill of an array of Indian peoples. Lacking the advantages in population and in the price and quality of trade goods enjoyed by their British rivals, the French developed their Indian diplomacy into a fine art. French officers and agents lived in Indian country, married Indian wives, learned Indian ways, and became adept at speaking Indian languages. They followed appropriate protocol, smoking the long-stemmed calumet or peace pipe, presenting and receiving wampum belts, giving gifts, and making lengthy orations. Failure to do so was courting disaster. When Antoine de la Motte Cadillac, founder of Detroit and governor of Louisiana, refused to stop and smoke the calumet with the Natchez Indians on a 1715 trip down the Mississippi, the Natchez interpreted the refusal as an act of war and killed four French traders in retaliation. Preserving Indian alliances was expensive and time-consuming, but ultimately unavoidable. "One is a slave to Indians in this country," wrote one French officer. In the heart of the continent, Indians remained in control well into the 18th century. Some Indian people incorporated the outsiders into their kinship systems and exchange networks, but the onus was on the Europeans to adjust to Indian ways when they dealt with the powerful Osages between the Missouri and Red Rivers and with the Caddos, Comanches, Lipan Apaches, and Wichitas who held the upper hand in Texas. In the Southwest, after the Pueblo Revolt, Spaniards learned to temper force with diplomacy in their dealings with Indian peoples. In the 18th century, when mounted Ute, Comanche, and Apache nomads proved more than a match for heavily equipped Spanish soldiers in thinly spread garrisons, Spaniards came to rely on Pueblo and Pima allies and on diplomacy to defend their provinces. Despite a reputation for unrelenting land hunger that prevented anything but hostile and exploitive relations with Indians, the British, like the Spanish, also became skilled in the art of diplomacy and recognized the importance of Indians to their imperial ambitions. "The importance of Indians is now generally known and understood," wrote South Carolina merchant and superintendent of Indian affairs Edmund Atkin in his report to the Board of Trade in England in 1755. "A doubt remains not that the prosperity of our colonies on the continent will stand or fall with our interest in favoring among them. While they are our friends, they are the cheapest and strongest barrier for the protection of our settlements. When enemies, they are capable by ravaging in their method of war, in spite of all we can do, to render those possessions almost useless." Englishmen regarded treaties and property deeds as legitimate ways to acquire Indian lands, even though they sometimes practiced fraud and deception in securing these documents. They also used treaties as a forum in which to assert that Indians were subjects of the king, that they were subject to English laws, that they must provide assistance against the French and hostile Indian tribes, and that Indians bore responsibility for past conflicts. Indians regarded treaties and councils as an opportunity to make and cement alliances, air their grievances, secure goods and guarantees in return for land, and exercise a small measure of control over the diminution of their homelands. They also often had different understandings of what they were conveying when they sold land. Indians affixed their names to treaty documents that sometimes differed greatly from what they had said in council. Sometimes they were deceived into signing documents that contained statements they were not aware of and to which they would never have agreed. Sometimes Indian delegates changed their minds or succumbed to persuasion or coercion. Sometimes errors in translation created genuine misunderstandings. Indians also, on occasion, rejected English claims to sovereignty and jurisdiction and pointed out English breaches of former agreements. Indians who read the texts of treaties or had them read to them sometimes complained that, quote, "these writings appear to contain things that are not," end quote, and cited English misinterpretations and misrepresentations of their words point by point. Nevertheless, the English established the system of treaty making as the principal means by which to acquire and legitimize the acquisition of Indian land, inherited and continued by the U.S. government. This system was the vehicle through which much of America passed from Indian to non-Indian hands. Anglo-Indian relations varied from colony to colony. Indian leaders often dealt with representatives of several colonies. They sometimes exploited the situation to their advantage and to preserve their independence. In Pennsylvania, William Penn and the Quakers earned a reputation in the late 17th century for fair dealings with the Indians by obtaining their lands through negotiated treaties and deeds. But the Quakers lost control of the colonial legislature, and unfair trade practices, demands for Indian land, and the influx of land-hungry Scots-Irish settlers turned Pennsylvania into a bloody battleground in the 18th century. The Delawares lost the last of their lands in the upper Delaware and Lehigh Valleys in the infamous Walking Purchase of 1737, when Pennsylvanians produced a team of runners to measure out an old deed that supposedly granted William Penn and his heirs land, quote, "as far as a man may go in a day and a half," end quote. In the second half of the century, William Penn's peaceable kingdom became a zone of racial hatred and frontier conflict with no place for cultural mediators, a decline into violence that revealed the final incompatibility of colonial and native dreams about the continent they shared. The Delawares continued to retreat westward before the advancing edge of the colonial frontier. In New York, the Iroquois dealt with the Dutch until 1664. After the English takeover, they shifted their diplomatic attentions to the British Crown and its representatives, building an alliance they likened to the links of a covenant chain and entering King William's War against the French in 1689. But the war took a heavy toll. French campaigns struck Iroquois villages, and starvation stalked the longhouses. By 1700, the Iroquois population had been cut in half. Iroquois diplomats traveled to Montreal, to Albany, and to the Great Lakes region to make peace with France, Britain, and their Indian allies. They charted a new course of neutrality between competing powers that allowed them to halt their losses, restore some power, and remain autonomous. The Six Nations were key players in the contest for North America. The Iroquois combined statesmanship with a reputation for military prowess and held the balance of power in northeastern North America well into the 18th century. They compelled the British, like the French, to deal with them on Iroquois terms, paying constant attention to keeping strong the covenant chain that symbolically linked the Iroquois and their allies. Even the Albany Congress of 1754, an important step in forging unity among the British colonies, was a cultural encounter, where colonial officials met with Iroquois men who spoke on wampum belts and Indian women strung belts for use in council. The British superintendent of Indian affairs in the North during the mid-18th century, Sir William Johnson, set the tone of the British Indian Department for more than a generation. A former trader, the Irishman Johnson took a Mohawk wife, immersed himself in Mohawk culture, spoke Mohawk, and became an expert practitioner in the intricate world of Iroquois politics. Known to Mohawks as Rawagiage, he who does much business, or a man who undertakes great things, he cultivated good relations with important chiefs, gave generous gifts, and mastered the protocol of council fire diplomacy. Other agents of the British Indian Department also married into Indian societies and functioned as intermediaries between crown and tribe. European Indian agents learned to speak Indian languages, understand the metaphors of Indian speeches, interpret wampum belts, smoke the Calumet pipe, and provide a steady flow of gifts that indicated that they were men of their word and representatives of a powerful and generous king. In turn, Indians had to adjust and hone their diplomatic skills to survive and succeed in a dangerous new world where European powers and various colonies competed for their trade and allegiance and recorded agreements in writing rather than wampum. Powerful and strategically located tribes like the Iroquois in New York and the Choctaws in the lower Mississippi Valley played one European power off another to secure trade while maintaining independence. The Creek Indians, a loose confederation of some 50 autonomous towns in Georgia and Alabama, also attempted to pursue policies of neutrality as three European powers competed for dominance in the Southeast, even though individual towns cultivated their own relations with British colonies and British traders. "To preserve the balance between us and the French," wrote one British colonial official, "is the great ruling principle of the modern Indian politics." Smaller tribes surrounded by European populations sometimes pursued similar strategies at a local level. The Catawbas of South Carolina, reduced to fewer than 500 people by 1760 and dependent on Europeans for trade goods, admitted, quote, "We cannot live without the assistance of the English," end quote. But as historian James Murrell observes, they were not willing to become English themselves. Indian leaders soon realized that Europeans who invited them to the treaty table generally wanted their land, resources, or young men as soldiers. They juggled competing demands, weighing what they gave against what they got, walking a fine line to preserve their independence in an environment of increasing dependency. Indians, thus plugged into these networks of trade, commerce, and consumption, saw their material worlds transformed. Muskets replaced bows and arrows for hunting and warfare. Metal cooking and eating utensils replaced traditional pottery utensils and culinary techniques, and the adoption and adaptation of European-style clothing altered the ways Indians presented themselves to each other and to others. An important fact to keep in mind here is that while the French and the Dutch, and later the British, were happy to trade their technology to the Indians, that did not come with any information about the production or maintenance of these tools. Indians were largely prohibited from acquiring the equipment and know-how for manufacturing firearms, repairing malfunctioning guns, or making bullets, for example. To some extent, they were able to figure out how to make simple repairs, but a warped barrel or a broken flintlock mechanism forced an Indian to find a gunsmith who could fix or replace parts or gather the funds necessary to buy a new weapon. The colonists recognized the slippery slope of dependency as well as did the Indians, and exploited this dependency to individual and collective advantage. Look here at this portrait of Thayanguin, sachem of the Mohawks through much of the early 18th century. Here he is dressed in the uniform of a British army officer that he would wear whenever he had to deal directly with colonial leaders or British military officers. He was clearly aware that presenting himself in this fashion granted him a higher degree of political legitimacy, enhanced by his good command of the English language, and made his white counterparts more comfortable, dealing, as it would seem, with a civilized man. There is little reason to think that he dressed this way normally or would have walked around his home village in these clothes, but he clearly knew that doing so at those times when he would have to travel to Albany, New York City, Montreal, or elsewhere was far more advantageous than appearing in a more traditional Iroquoian style, which most whites equated with primitive savagery. The many different peoples, faiths, and communities that characterized the North American colonies arose from the somewhat haphazard policies of the 18th century British Empire. Unlike Spain and France, whose policies of excluding Protestants and foreigners kept the population of their North American colonial territories small, Britain kept the door to its colonies open to anyone. Tens of thousands of non-British immigrants settled in the British colonies and raised families. The open door did not extend to trade, however. The 17th century Navigation Acts restricted colonial trade to British ships and traders. These policies evolved because they served the interests of the monarchy and of influential groups in Britain. The policies also gave the colonists a common framework of political expectations and experiences. British attempts to exercise political power in their colonial governments met with success so long as British officials were on or very near the sea. Colonists accepted British authority to collect customs duties, inspect cargoes, and enforce trade regulations, although they did not always follow the rules. But when royal officials tried to wield their authority in the internal affairs of the colonies, they invariably met resistance. A governor appointed by the king in each of the 9 royal colonies or by the proprietors in Maryland and Pennsylvania headed the government of each colony. Rhode Island and Connecticut, being the exceptions, selected their own governors. The British believed colonial governors were like mini monarchs, able to exert influence in the colonies much as did the king in Britain. But colonial governors were not kings, and the colonies were not Britain. It is important to note that the American political landscape was supposed to be an exact copy of that in Britain, but such was really never the case. By the 1720s, in both Britain and its mainland colonies in North America, the right to vote and hold elected office depended upon land ownership. Adult men, usually defined as being at least 20 years old, who owned land worth at least 40 shillings qualified for the right to vote. As you may recall, the British Isles are not very big, and so land was very hard to come by since over 80% of it was owned by the Crown, the nobility, the gentry, and the Church of England. Consequently, only about 30% of the adult male population of the British Isles enjoyed the right to vote, with office holding dominated by the nobility and the landed gentry. In the royal colonies, those wherein the king appointed the governors, the minimum real estate value one had to own in order to vote was usually set at around £40. Now bear in mind that 12 shillings makes £1. While other places did grant voting rights to men who were heads of household and leased at least 100 acres of land, this much higher bar would seem to ensure that the percentage of potential voters would be about the same in New York, Massachusetts, or Virginia as in England or Scotland, but it wasn't. In most colonies, about 60% of the adult white male population had the right to vote, prompting Massachusetts Lieutenant Governor Thomas Hutchinson to complain in 1760 that, quote, "anything with the appearance of a man can vote in Massachusetts," end quote. English visitors to the colonies remarked on the highly democratic nature of the colonials, and the colonists themselves often prided themselves on how the privileges enjoyed by the landed gentry in Britain were more broadly enjoyed by Americans, the colonies already being billed as a land of opportunity. Although the royal governors technically spoke and acted on the king's behalf, and therefore had his effective powers in the colonies, their salaries set in London were paid out of colonial tax revenues collected and dispensed by the assemblies. This meant that any governor who alienated his assembly risked seeing his salary payments either reduced or cut off altogether. A wise colonial governor knew that he had to establish good working relationships with the leading men in the assembly in order to meet the demands placed on him by the king, while arrogant or stupid governors bullied or antagonized the assemblyman who had a powerful means to bring such an ass to heel. The governor could dissolve a recalcitrant assembly and call for new elections, but the dismissed assemblyman would simply urge their constituents to vote them back into office to fight for their rights against a high and mighty governor. An early case in point was the royal governor of New York, Edward Hyde, Lord Cornbury, in the 1700s. A cousin of Queen Anne, he presumed that his rank and reputation would overawe the provincials he expected would then do his bidding. He clashed with the assembly, who cut off his salary, to which he responded by dissolving the assembly, only to find most of the same troublesome men in the chamber when it reconvened after the elections. Letters of complaint against him were sent to influential members of Parliament, while he wrote reports dripping with frustration and condescension about, quote, these damned rascals. Then New York's newspapers began to report that the governor was prone to indulge a penchant for dressing in women's clothes and parading around in public, someone going so far as to commission an artist to paint a portrait of him in drag. Lord Cornbury denied the accusations, and it is possible that they are nothing more than part of a malicious smear campaign, but some prominent New Yorkers attested to the truth of the rumors, and it is possible that he may have indeed appeared in public in a dress, but some have theorized that what he was doing was underscoring his blood relationship to the Queen and that he stood for her in New York, and so was only engaging in a bit of representative theater. There's no way to know for sure, but you can find this portrait at the Dallas Museum of Art in the American Art Wing, so you can check it out for yourself. Even the best-intentioned colonial governors had difficulty winning the trust and respect of influential colonists because their terms of office averaged just 5 years and could be terminated at any time. Colonial governors controlled few patronage positions in the colonies that would have allowed them to build political friendships. Obedient and loyal to their superiors in Britain, colonial governors fought with colonial assemblies. They battled over issues such as governors' vetoes of colonial legislation, removal of colonial judges, and dismissal of the representative assemblies. During the 18th century, the authority of governors declined as the assemblies gained the upper hand. Since British policies did not clearly define the colonists' legal powers, colonial assemblies seized the opportunity to make their own rules. Gradually, the assemblies established a strong tradition of representative government similar in their eyes to the British Parliament. Voters often returned the same representatives to the assemblies year after year, building continuity in power and leadership that far exceeded that of a governor. By 1720, colonial assemblies had won the power to initiate legislation, including tax laws and authorizations to spend public funds. Although all laws passed by the assemblies, except in Maryland, Rhode Island, and Connecticut, had to be approved by the governor and then by the Board of Trade in Britain, the difficulties in communication about complex subjects over long distances effectively ratified the assembly's decisions. Years often passed before colonial laws were repealed by British authorities, and in the meantime, the assembly's laws prevailed. The heated political struggles between royal governors and colonial assemblies that occurred throughout the 18th century taught colonists a common set of political lessons. They learned to employ traditionally British ideas of representative government to defend their own colonial interests. More importantly, they learned that power inside the British colonies rarely belonged to the British government. During the 18th century, a society that was distinctively colonial and distinctively British emerged in North America. Tens of thousands of immigrants and slaves gave the colonies an unmistakably colonial complexion and contributed to the colonies' growing population and expanding economy. People of different ethnicities and faiths sought their fortunes in the colonies, where land was cheap, labor was dear, and work promised to be rewarding. Indentured servants and redemptioners risked temporary periods of bondage for the potential reward of better opportunities in the colonies than those found in the Old World. Slaves arrived in unprecedented numbers and endured lifelong servitude, which they neither chose nor desired, but from which their masters greatly benefited. None of the European colonies could claim complete dominance of North America. The desire to expand and defend their territorial claims meant that the English, French, and Spanish colonies periodically fought one another, as well as the Indians upon whose land they encroached. In varying degrees, all colonists sought to influence or control Native Americans and their land, their military power, their trade, and even their souls. Spanish missionaries and soldiers sought to convert Indians on the West Coast and exploit their labor. French alliances with Indian tribes posed a formidable barrier to westward expansion of the British Empire. Yet despite attempts to secure their New World holdings, Spanish and French colonists did not develop societies that began to rival the European empires that sponsored and supported them. They did not participate in the cultural, economic, social, and religious changes experienced by their counterparts in British North America, nor did they share in the emerging political identity of the British colonists. Colonial products from New England, the Middle Colonies, and the Southern Colonies flowed to the West Indies and across the Atlantic. Back came unquestionably British consumer goods along with fashions in ideas, faith, and politics. The bonds of the British Empire required colonists to think of themselves as British subjects and, at the same time, encouraged them to consider their status as colonists. By 1770, British colonists in North America could not imagine that their distinctive dual identity as British and as colonists would soon become a source of intense conflict.